Hello and welcome to week 14 of Introduction to Psychology. Today we're going to be talking about chapter 15, Abnormal Psychology Disorders and Treatments. When we go to address diagnoses of abnormal behavior that we define as disorders, we take a biopsychosocial approach. We're asking the questions of how is the biology, how are genetics associated with disorders, how is our brain structure, our brain chemistry and cognitions associated with disorders, and then how is the social context, your behavior in the social context, and how what in the social context influences disorders, okay? Whenever we're talking about disorders, we have to have cultural references because what is normal in one place may be abnormal in another. For example, if you're in Iraq and you're very paranoid all the time and you're carrying a gun around, that might seem normal. But if you're in America and you're paranoid and you're carrying a gun around, we might call that abnormal. So disorders are influenced by culture, and we are going to take a biopsychosocial approach. Whenever we want to categorize disorders, the DSM-5, what's the version we're on now, is where we go for our references, okay? The DSM-5 breaks the disorders into categories. It has all the symptoms, the checklists, how many of these symptoms you have to be, you know, to actually have that disorder, for example. So that's our reference book. These are a list of the disorders. The ones we're really going to focus on are anxiety disorders. We're going to look at schizophrenia. We're going to look at dissociative disorders and depressive disorders, a little bit of eating disorders, substance abuse disorders, personality disorders. Those are the ones we're going to look at. But again, there's several more. So definitely worthy of spending a little time doing the research on that. Okay. When it comes to disorders, you're going to find that one single category often is not sufficient. Oftentimes, you have these blends of different categories. So, for example, somebody that has anxiety disorder might also suffer from depression symptoms, which then influence personality disorders like antisocial behavior, for example. So you can see that there can often be a blend. First, we're going to talk about anxiety disorders. The book opens up talking about generalized anxiety disorders. These are times when people have just general sense of stress and anxiety throughout the day that persists for a long period of time, okay? Panic disorders, that's associated with fears that are often irrational, okay? These can also cause anxiety and panic attacks. Again, it's a biopsychosocial process in that your thoughts can then influence your body. Okay, so something to think about. The book also talks about phobias, and these are just general fears. And these are irrational, but they can affect us in a lot of ways. Okay, some common phobias, public places, heights, snakes. How much of our fears and our phobias are evolutionary and how much of them are learned, for example. So we all have an evolutionary adaptation to a fear of snakes, but we don't have an evolutionary adaptation to a fear of alcohol. So for example, when it comes to morning sickness, a lot of reason women have morning sickness is that's their body informing them that this is not a substance you should have, okay? And so you end up with the morning sickness. And the same thing doesn't happen when a pregnant woman has alcohol because we haven't developed this aversion to alcohol yet in our biology, okay? So a lot of our fears, our phobias are built into our biology. A lot of them are new, relatively new technologies like alcohol. So we haven't built these into our biology, for example, okay? So treatment of phobias, the book talks about exposure therapy, like if you're afraid of spiders, go in a tank full of spiders. I'm not a huge fan, but you know, it's scary to me. I don't really want to confront a bunch of spiders. That's also known as systematic desensitization. Also, what's effective is things like behavior modification, changing the way we think about it, the way our cognitions approach our fears, for example. The book also talks about obsessive compulsive disorder. This is defined by repetitive streams of thoughts that you're kind of focused on something and you're obsessed with, or compulsions like this need to do something, to engage in a specific action, okay? The book also talks about substance-related disorders, and substance-related disorders are associated with dependence. Again, a biopsychosocial process. A lot of dependence is learned, but a lot of dependence is built into our genetics, okay? So you have to consider genetics and family background when you're talking about addiction to alcoholism, when you're talking about addiction to opiates, okay? So when it comes to substance abuse disorder, again, biopsychosocial, a lot of it's your body and your craving and your desires. And a lot of it's the way you think and maybe the way you learned. And then a lot of it's the social context and the things that you were exposed to, for example, okay? So the book also covers mood disorders, schizophrenia, and autism. So depression is an example of a mood disorder. So you have a major depressive depression disorder, which is the experience of chronic depression. Then you have seasonal affective disorder that just kind of happens randomly throughout the year. We haven't totally found a gene that's associated with depression, but as with personality, there's a lot of genes that interact. So there are some research that genetics are associated with depression, for example. And then often when people have these depressions, it tends to blend over into other issues such as substance abuse disorder and things along those lines. Okay, so treatment for some of this, you have antidepressant medications, you have therapy. Okay, and all of these have different forms of effect. You have your mood leveling for like bipolar disorder, like lithium. And then you have other cognitive behavioral therapy to help you learn how to change the way you think, to change the way you behave, for example. Historically, they've done some things like surgery and convulsive shock therapy, which is not really acceptable in modern times, and that hasn't happened in a lot of times. But that's something you hear about a lot when you hear about psychology. And of course, bipolar disorder is the chronic mood swings that go on for a long period of time, the cycle of depression to mania, the cycle of depression to mania, okay? That's just a continuous cycle that goes on forever. Schizophrenia, this is not what you guys would normally think. A lot of times when you think about schizophrenia, you're thinking about multiple personalities, and this is not a multiple personality disorder. Schizophrenia, the idea of schizophrenia is this idea of a split mind, becoming split from reality, okay? And some of the symptoms include hallucinations, delusions, disorganized speech, so this is what schizophrenia is really about. It's more like a detached from reality, okay? And schizophrenia definitely comes out in your mid-teens, 15 to 20 to their 30s, okay? So college is often a major onset time for a lot of the disorders you're going to find. But schizophrenia, again, is not what we think is like, you know, you have multiple personalities and you're a different person each time. It's just that your understanding of reality has changed and the way you think about reality and the thoughts that you focus on are just a little bit different, okay? So they really look at brain abnormalities with schizophrenia, and you can look at the brain from a schizophrenic and a non-schizophrenic, and you can see in the center of the areas, different areas of growth and things along those lines. So generally, schizophrenia is treated with drugs. Treating schizophrenia with therapy alone is not generally very effective, okay? Autism spectrum disorder is an attention disorder, and again, this is when we really start to look at the neuropsychology. When we start to look at brain structure and how that works, how different areas of your brain should not be talking, but they are. So autism spectrum disorder is just an attention disorder, okay? It's an inability to really focus your attention on just one thing. Oftentimes, it's associated with being able to, almost like a photographic memory, take in all the stimulus at once. But the biggest problem with autistics is this idea that you're taking in so much stimuli that you can't organize it, nor do you even have the time for it. It's often symptomatic of impaired social relationships, inability to communicate, for example. Okay, so just something to think about. So psychotherapy is the next thing we're going to talk about. And so you have a couple of different people that engage in therapy. You have your clinical psychologist, you have your group and family psychologist, you have your counselors, and then you have your psychiatrist that focus more a little bit more on medicine and things like that with a little bit of counseling mixed in. So when we go to do therapy, you have your Freudian influenced psychoanalysis or psychodynamic therapies that really focus on unconscious processes. Okay, then we have behavioral therapy. The goal of behavioral therapy is to modify your actual behavior. And then cognitive therapy is modifying the way you think. And then, of course, the blend of cognitive behavior, modifying the way you think to modify the way that you behave, okay? Humanistic therapy focuses on a whole person-centered focus. It's all about self-actualization and fulfilling your potential, goal outcome, things like that. Family systems and group therapies, these are associated with improving, you know, unhealthy relationships, improving harmful relationships, helping people heal in their relationships. Is psychotherapy effective? So again, therapy is very effective. So you have to look at whether drugs on their own are good, whether you want a combination of drugs and therapy, or whether therapy on its own is the best. And so you'll find different results depending on what you have. You know, sometimes people need the medication. Therapy helps, but without the medication, no amount of therapy is going to help. Some people don't need the medication. Really, they just need therapy. But oftentimes, if you have a little bit of a blend of the medicine and therapy, you can really help things in the long term. So commonly, people get some drugs and some therapy so that they can improve over the long term. Okay? Community psychologist is a new form, is people going out and looking at society and trying to help the health, you know, help the psychological health of society. And then how do we prevent mental disorders? Again, what can we as a society do to help reduce the association of mental institutions? Okay, so we've started to reduce the amount of mental institutions that we have. Again, we are now focusing more on treating the person, helping them to be able to live, for example. Okay, so hope you guys enjoyed the lecture on disorders, and please, if you have any questions, email. Thank you so much, and have a wonderful day.